Hey everybody, I'm Nick Shell and Tucker from the amazing event always. So I'm here today to talk a little bit about carbon removal. So to quick show of hands, how many of you in the audience are familiar with the concept? All right, pretty much everybody. Great. And you know, I see a few carbon removal experts scattered around, folks who've been working in carbon markets for a long time. So I know later today we're going to be talking a little bit about some of the markets for carbon, investments for carbon, but what I really want to go back to is the math, and particularly contextualizing some of the math that Shannon just mentioned in the context of where we are today and our global climate goals. So, put pretty simply, I think we all know it. We've released too much carbon, right, and other greenhouse gases. We have taken this material out of long-term storage out of this slow carbon cycle where it would have otherwise been for a really long time, and we've moved it up in the atmosphere and the surface ocean. What you see here on the bottom line is this 1.5 degree Celsius pathway. Functionally, the ambitious goal that was set via the Paris Agreement, via the United Nations, about where we want to be by the middle of the century and beyond. And you can see where we are today, and you know, we're creeping back down towards that line, and we're seeing some of the emissions flattening that we've been hoping for, but not nearly fast enough. And we know, of course, that fossil fuels are the main cause of this problem, right? 75% of the greenhouse gas emissions, nearly 90% of all carbon dioxide emissions. So what that tells us, and particularly what the IPCC, which is functionally the UN scientific body, tells us, is that we need to remove a whole bunch of that carbon orbiting the atmosphere and the surface ocean, and we need to do it super fast, to the tune of up to 10 gigatons annually a year, in addition to the immediate reduction of CO2 across all economic sectors. And I want to focus on that for a second, because we've seen these two curves here, right, where one is coming down really fast, really dramatically, and the other one has to ramp up and scale like no industry we've ever seen before. But that's assuming all of our global climate goals are assuming the pace of decarbonization where we're stopping tomorrow and we're functionally going off a cliff from now until 2030, right? If you guys have been going to other climate events throughout the course of this week, you're probably hearing about AI emissions intensity, you're probably hearing about these new technologies and the competition for some of the renewable energy research that we're bringing online. And functionally, what that creates is a situation where we have a carbon debt, right? We remember 2020, 2021, we were all living at home, you know, staying inside and talking about trying to flatten the curve. Very similar situation here when we think about carbon, right? Which is the longer and the higher that emissions curve continues to rise, and before it starts to come down dramatically, the more of this carbon debt we are building, right? We're contributing to, and that's what we essentially have to buy down over time through carbon removal. So what the IPCC tells us, right, this is sort of the standard definition of carbon removal, anthropogenic activities, human-caused activities that remove carbon from the atmosphere, from the surface ocean, store it thoroughly. That could be in geologic reservoirs, so deep underground, that could be in terrestrial ecosystems, forestry, et cetera, store it in products. Near-term, that's going to help us cap that carbon debt. Medium-term, that helps us get back down towards net zero. And then long-term, that's what helps us, you know, keep those parts per million in the atmosphere from going down. And there's a whole bunch of ways to do this, right? There are natural processes, afforestation, reforestation, regenerative agriculture processes that might store carbon over shorter time periods. There are highly technical solutions, factories that can, you know, suck CO2 out of the sky. There are geochemical kinds of pathways that speed up the natural processes by which the Earth removes carbon chemically. And one of the challenges we see right now as this field is growing and it's becoming really interesting for folks to come work on it is there are a lot of different ways to bucket this, right? You have nature-based solutions, you have technological solutions, you've got open systems and closed systems. So open systems, these ones that are utilizing nature and natural processes to remove carbon sort of on our behalf, closed systems that are highly measurable. You've got what's called high durability and low durability. How long is that carbon going to be stored for? Is there potential for leakage? What's the long-term damage that might be associated with that? Biotic and abiotic, or biological and geochemical. So are you using photosynthesis and this natural leverage that plants provide us? Or are you trying to tap into the alkalinity in the way that the Earth serves chemically? And you guys might be surprised to see this on the slide, but geoengineering, right? What defines the category of geoengineering? What defines these categories of carbon removal? When it comes to things like policy and markets and figuring out how to scale these solutions, how people see these different categories is a really critical component of even being able to prove up the research associated with some of these processes. So the last thing I really want to leave you with is, what do we value, right? Because we are increasingly finding more and more sophisticated and interesting and scalable ways that we can potentially remove carbon, right? Some of those are going to have massive co-benefits, right? The ability to promote biodiversity, enhance local communities, you know, work with frontline communities who are feeling climate change most dramatically. Some of those are going to rely working on with the oil and gas industry, with energy companies who have the infrastructure, who have the understanding and the ability to move mass around. Some of those things are going to be really hard to measure, but might be super scalable. Some of those might require a huge amount of energy use, where we have a high degree of confidence about the carbon that is removed. So when it comes to this portfolio of solutions that can potentially remove carbon, what we value and what we're prioritizing when it comes to which of these can scale can really make or break which of these solutions might take off over time, which ones might be able to tap into funding and policy resources. And we might look back 10, 20 years from now and say, wow, we really prioritize this solution because, you know, we invested in it early. So really being intentional at the start as all of these new approaches to removing carbon emerge is going to be a really important part of this.